What is schizophrenia? That's what I'm talking about today. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and this channel is about mental health education and self-improvement. If you don't want to miss an episode, click subscribe and the notification bell. This video is based on a viewer question from Joe PR. Very informative video, as always, Dr. Marks. Could you do a video on schizophrenia and its treatment? I would find it educative to have a psychiatrist's opinion on what is probably the most stigmatized mental illness in modern society. Thank you. Thank you, Joe PR, for that question. Schizophrenia is the most serious disorder that we have in psychiatry. It's much more than hallucinations. It's an illness where the person's main problem is being psychotic. With psychosis, you're not able to tell what's real and what's not real. I'll link a video in the corner that I did on psychosis. You can have psychotic symptoms like hallucinations for different reasons, like having a reaction to a steroid medication, just as an example. But with schizophrenia, there are several symptoms, and here's how we define the illness using the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 5th edition. You have to have two of the five psychotic symptoms. Delusions, which are fixed false beliefs, and the person cannot be convinced that they're wrong. And this is more than believing you're the best at soccer, because that's subjective. This would be something like your spouse was duplicated from a skin tag taken from the outer quadrant of your calf. Hallucinations. These can affect any of your five senses. The more common hallucinations, though, are auditory, which are hearing things that aren't there, and visual, which are seeing things that aren't there. One important thing to remember is these hallucinations happen when you're completely alert, awake, and clear. This does not include hallucinations that anyone can have when you're falling asleep or waking up. Disorganized thinking. We call this a formal thought disorder. This is usually something that other people notice by the way you talk. You may answer questions in a way that's only slightly related to what the person said, and it makes sense in your mind, but the person listening isn't quite sure what you mean. And you may hear people say things like, you're talking in code. And that's because what you say sounds related, but not really. And if you talk for a while, the person listening may not even remember what they asked. Another way you can experience this is having your thoughts get derailed such that you're switching from topic to topic. And the topics might be loosely connected and make sense to you, but to the person listening, it sounds like you're just trailing way off topic. And we call this tangential thinking, when the trail off doesn't get back to the original point. Now, there are many people who are naturally talkative and include excessive detail in their stories. We call this circumstantial speech or thoughts, when you get off topic, but you're able to come back to where you were eventually. Circumstantial speech is not a part of a thought disorder that's associated with schizophrenia. A fourth symptom of schizophrenia is disorganized behavior. And this is more than having a junky room. This is major levels of internal disorganization that get in the way of daily functioning. I've seen people who are so impaired that they smear feces on the wall. Another way it can look is the person has outbursts of agitation. Sometimes it can be outbursts of laughing for seemingly no reason. And this is not because you're thinking about a funny video you've watched. You may be thinking, might not be thinking about anything, and may even feel like your head is completely empty, but you're laughing and disturbing people. The last manifestation of schizophrenia is negative symptoms, and this is not as easy to recognize or understand. The first four symptoms that I mentioned are called positive symptoms. The best way to think about the negative symptoms is you're not responding to your environment in the usual expected way. And it's usually not something that you notice about yourself. What other people will notice is they'll see dramatically decreased facial expressions or complete lack of eye contact or failure to initiate movement or speech. So you may sit in a room with very little stimulation around you doing nothing. And it's hard for someone without a mental disorder to sit unstimulated for long periods of time. We need sensory input in any form. Someone talking to you, touching you, having something to read or listen to. But with the person with negative symptoms, they need much less of this. So you can sit and do nothing and have nothing going on. So those are the five symptoms, and you must have two of them going on at the same time for at least a month. And these symptoms cause serious problems in your social life, work, academic life, or family life. So I don't want you to think, I heard someone call my name last week. Does that mean I'm schizophrenic? No, not from that one symptom alone. In fact, schizophrenia is so disabling, you shouldn't need to think hard to find two of these things that you did sometime in the past and question if you have schizophrenia. A couple of features that go along with this is lack of insight and cognitive problems. When you're delusional, you don't know that you're delusional. It's real to you. You only realize it's a delusion after the symptoms have passed. And they don't pass in a couple of hours, at least not when it's from schizophrenia. When it comes to the hallucinations, some people can experience continual voices talking in the background that they're able to ignore as long as their ability to ignore it depends on the volume of the voices and what they're saying. I've had some patients who were comforted by the presence of the voices as long as they weren't saying mean things, because with the voices, they didn't feel alone. And that's in contrast to someone who bangs their head because the voices are just so overwhelming for them. Another feature of schizophrenia that sets it apart from other illnesses where psychosis is present is cognitive deficits. These cognitive deficits are things like memory problems, life planning and organizational problems, and impaired thought processing. And this is one of the biggest differences in someone with bipolar disorder who becomes psychotic and someone and the person with schizophrenia. So if you were to look at both people side by side while they are in a psychotic state, the person with bipolar disorder will have prominent mood symptoms like depression or mania, and the person with schizophrenia will not. The person with bipolar disorder will have delusions that usually match their mood state at the time. So if the person's depressed, their delusions may have excessively guilty themes to them, like they don't deserve to live or they've disappointed the world in some way. Whereas the person with schizophrenia will have mood-neutral delusions that are usually, but not always, bizarre. A non-bizarre delusion would be that all doctors in the hospital are poisoning you by putting toxins in your pills. Also, the psychotic person with schizophrenia will have a history of poor functioning, like serious academic problems or inability to keep a job or serious problems on the job. Whereas the person with bipolar disorder, who's psychotic at the time, will have a functioning level that was higher prior to their episode coming on. Yes, depression can cause thinking problems like memory problems, but with schizophrenia, you have thinking problems without any depression or mania being present. One last thing to mention when it comes to diagnostic terms, and that's schizoaffective disorder. Think of schizoaffective disorder as a combination of bipolar disorder or unipolar depression plus schizophrenia. So you have these mood episodes, but in between the mood episodes, you still have psychotic symptoms. On that note, schizophrenia is not episodic like depression and bipolar disorder. It's more constant. So you can have ups and downs in response to situational stressors, but it's not something where you have these periods of no symptoms at all. So there's a lot that goes into establishing this as a diagnosis, and there's lots of nuances here, as you can probably see. But this information is not so that you can diagnose yourself, it's just so that you can have more information to understand your illness once you have already been diagnosed. We don't know exactly what causes schizophrenia. It can be inherited and run in families, and there have been associations linked between birth complications and older paternal age. But we don't have a strong enough link to establish these things as causes. It tends to show up somewhere between late teens and early 30s, but the peak age of onset is early 20s for men and late 20s for women. We treat schizophrenia with antipsychotic medications. The goal is a complete resolution of symptoms, but that usually doesn't happen, especially when you consider the hit that it takes on your thinking abilities. The medications help keep the positive symptoms like the delusions and the hallucinations under control. Some of the newer antipsychotic medications can help with the negative symptoms, but in my experience, those usually remain at some level. Social skills training, though, can help with some of these things, like the eye contact and improving your conversation. That's the short version on schizophrenia. Share this video and spread the knowledge. And talk to me in the comments. But keep in mind, I can't diagnose you in the comments. And you don't want someone online diagnosing you anyway. There's a lot of information that the doctor needs to know from you to make a diagnosis. So if you suspect that you have this problem, you should see a psychiatrist for an evaluation. See you next time. This life.